Oh, that's right. It's Rinkside episode 26. Pawtai here. Unfortunately, our beloved Chewy Canadian is out of the office. So we got a short and sweet episode for you today. But let me tell you, things are going well in Chicago. I know that I'm the number one you always want to hear about, Pawtai's penthouse. Chewy's corner is cool, but you know, the view from up at the penthouse is just a little bit better. So nothing new in this world, but let me tell you about what's going down in goals. We have the new minors coaches that just got announced. Want to congratulate Robert Thump for the Beijing Bucks. We've got Captain Wicket for the Berlin Snowhawks, Jacob Bholes for the Iceland Ice, David Hume for the Malmö Royals, RJ Corker for the Sydney Whales, Yodi Logic for the Tokyo Tigers, Rock Steele for the Warsaw Warlocks, and Harry Cheddar from the Wellington Farmers. And shout out to a few of those players that are like rookie, minor players, or maybe going into their second season or just got drafted. Congrats. That's a big move for you all. Wish you all the best of luck. If you also haven't heard, the other update is now the new strategy sheet is crazy complex. It used to be like you clicked on five things and you set your lines. Now it's like you're playing a game of Risk. There are all these different pieces, and it's going to be a really compelling competition that emerges in this season in what team organization can come together and figure these out. How do you set the optimal strategies? How do you set the optimal lines? How do you create the synergy between the two? How do you dominate on the ice? To be determined in the upcoming season. So let me tell you, we've got a great guest coming on right now, the very famous James McRoss. All right, and for our feature presentation, we're greeted here with James McRoss. McRoss, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing well, thanks. How are you?
I'm doing, pretty fantastic. It's really an honor and an opportunity to be speaking with you. A lot of people in the league look up to you, including myself. So I must say it's an honor to have you on. How do you feel coming on to Rinkside?
Yeah, it's very nice to say. I'm excited to do this. Haven't done anything verbally before, so I'm looking forward to it.
Well, excellent. You know, I'm not trying to in any way reveal the person behind it. I respect the position that you've taken. So I've got a few questions. These are not, these are like more to understand, like, who do you see yourself as? So like, you know, what services do you provide to the league?
Yeah, I started as sort of a general insider. Now I consider myself more like a scout or draft analysis.
Mm-hmm. Do you work with any teams independently, or do you only provide for the Greater Goals community?
I just provide for the Greater Goals community. I do have some, I guess, owners and stuff that I'm a little bit closer with, but that's just part of the role.
Part of the role. And do you've said that it's evolved kind of over time. Do you have like a vision or a place that you want to take, like, you know, this identity that you've created?
Not too sure. Really, just kind of going as it goes and see what people respond to.
Okay. Well, excellent. So like, what do you do to prepare before a draft?
A lot of behind the scenes, especially during the season. Even when I'm not doing content, I'm always looking at stuff and looking at the builds and stuff like that. And then, just working on the mock drafts and the rankings and going from there.
So do you have like a prescripted methodology that you take and kind of apply to every draft, or do you see that it kind of changes over time?
I think it changes over time a little bit. I think activity is always kind of a priority for a lot of teams, but overall the way teams draft changes as the affiliation and pro spots and stuff change.
Mm-hmm. How do you get a pulse on the activity of a draftee?
I have access to the the prospects minors clubhouse. I don't see the team clubhouses, but I see the general prospects one, and I watch the Twitch chat and things like that.
Excellent. That's a lot of ground you covered. Do you have like a setup with like a multiple monitor display, or you're working off of like the cell phone, or like how do you kind of approach this?
A bit of everything. I do have an extra monitor at home and working the phones all the time.
Okay, always working the angles. Well, I'm curious, like you prepare for these things and then you deliver them to the community, and like, you know, how do people respond to them, and the big question is like, how does that like make you feel? How does that inspire you to like create additional content?
I think in general, most response have been pretty positive. Occasionally I do hear from the odd prospect that, you know, thinks they should be ranked higher, but that's just part of producing any sort of content, and you just kind of take the good with the bad and just try to remember that most people enjoy it, even if there's one or two that maybe feel slighted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to look at the bigger picture there. Sometimes there are stains that over time kind of fade into the background of the portrait. I'm kind of curious, when it comes to this year's draft, I have a scene where we can actually go and look at some of the picks and talk about them. But I wanted to, like, before we get into that, I was just kind of curious, what did you think of this year's draft overall?
I thought it was interesting. It had a lot of balance. Notice forwards and defensemen were pretty level across the board, at least in the early rounds. I think the early picks, there was a lot of really good picks, really active people, definitely deserving of the top slots for sure.
Hmm. Excellent. And did you think that it compared, or if you, how many drafts have you worked on, I guess, is an opening question.
Well, that's a good question. This was the sixth, so probably my fourth, maybe fifth.
Okay. Fourth or fifth. So over time, have you seen any like trends that you feel were exemplified or displayed in this draft as like, hey, this is, you know, a change in the way, or this is the way things are progressing?
Yeah, I saw each draft kind of has its own trend, I find. Some drafts have been very defenseman heavy, others a little more forward heavy. This one I noticed there was a run of defensemen for a while, but pretty balanced overall. And it, one thing that's changing over time and kind of a trend itself is that as more affiliation becomes a thing, it becomes more difficult to forecast what these teams are going to do because they don't have specific openings on their pro roster.
So that makes it like a greater degree of possibility of a position or type of build that somebody would elect to sign onto a team?
Yeah, because when somebody has a like a right wing opening or a forward opening, you can predict it's going to be one of this group of players, whereas an affiliate pick can be any position, and it's a lot harder to predict. They don't have specific archetype needs or positional needs, whereas they did in earlier drafts.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. So let's turn the focus to the actual draft that just occurred as I switch to a different tab and scroll all the way to the left. Now we have up the round one, and I kind of want to give this as like a blank canvas. I do have like two questions, is like, what surprised you as far as names here and what did you kind of expect? But, you know, this is like your domain. What did you think of like the first round?
I thought the teams did really well. A lot of the top picks were very active players, but also ones with quite a bit of progression under their belts. I think the two teams that needed to draft for pro spots did a good job at filling those roles with players who are ready to contribute right away. Max Jones and Bro Nevermind are both very highly rated defensemen, and I think should transition to the pro level very well. Beyond that, Pitts and Corker and Wicked, very active players at the top of the draft there. That run of defense in the middle, all very good players as well. And yeah, just a lot of very good active people here.
Excellent. And how did you feel that kind of compared to the second round?
The second round is normally where you start seeing some players that have a little bit less progression under their belt. And that's when relationships really start to become more important, I think. With the first round, there's a lot more value, I guess, on how good the player is right now and their general activity level. Whereas the second round, teams start to feel more comfortable reaching for their friends or people they've seen be a little more active in other leagues, even if they don't have the progressions already.
So these are more of like the investment plays where you buy into activity because that would mean commitment. These people are going to be retained. They're not going to leave the team, leave the league. And then maybe they might also go into staff or, other types of positions. Is that kind of a perspective to take on, a second round pick that might not have all the progressions or attributes yet?
Absolutely, especially with the affiliate part I mentioned before, where you have time to try to grow these players. Like if you look at picks 8, 9, and 10 of the second round, they all joined like right before the draft. I didn't have them in my mock draft, I don't think, because they joined so late. So that's definitely a kind of a example of what I'm talking about here.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That makes perfect sense. So they certainly have connections. So I've got two more rounds for you. Round three, what kind of happens in this one?
This one is where it gets really tough to predict because there's some players that start to slide that have been around for a while that probably should have gone earlier, but those second round friendships and things tend to push guys out of there. Another one, like Merle Maguire, I've heard has quite the reputation in some sim leagues, so it was interesting seeing him last this long. So I think he's a great pick. Thompson, Ragone, Buchholz, those are all guys that are very active so far, so I think they're going to be very solid picks.
Yeah, absolutely. And that brings us to the fourth round, the last one I've got here. So you said the last one had a bit of ambiguity to it. What do you think comes down in the fourth round? Is it more kind of unknown or, harder to forecast?
I think so. Yeah, it's when the later in the draft, it's a lot more about the friendships. Like I mentioned, you start to see in round two, but the later rounds is pretty much exclusively that, whether it's somebody you know from before or somebody that maybe you had a really good conversation with. And being a league expert and not a like a team manager, I don't get to see what those conversations are with these prospects, so it becomes really difficult to predict.
Interesting. So I guess I've got a few more kind of questions to wrap us out. We didn't show rounds 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. Was there anything from those rounds that you think's notable to interesting for like somebody to consider and what it takes to be able to predict that far ahead?
I think the one that jumps out at me is a situation like Chow Ming. He was a defenseman taken early in the sixth round. I believe his overall is 61 or something like that. So he's one of the higher rated players in the draft, but he fell that far. And I think that could be a sign of, teams not knowing him as well, but from an outside view, when you're making predictions and mock drafts, you know, I think I had him maybe late first or early second in my mock draft, just because of his skill on the ice and what I thought was a semi-active person, but he might have slid a little further than I expected, and that's just part of the unknown when it comes to predicting these kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, were there what teams or team did you feel like walked away like they did the best job in drafting, or your teams, you know, if you can't say one?
That's a good question. I mean, Albuquerque had the first pick, and it's hard to have a bad draft when you're picking first. And Tanner Pitts is a very good pick at the top of the draft, so I think they did really well there. Plus, you know, they traded for Hex Waters and made some other nice picks a little bit later on. So that's one that jumps out at me. I also think that, which team was it? I think Honolulu did really well. I really like all three of their picks in the first round. Wicked is a player I could have seen going first or second easily, and they got him at fourth. Future Considerations also probably should have been picked higher than ninth, so I think they did really well. And then obviously MASH later in the first did really well, and I think they got some good picks a little later on as well. I also like when teams draft kind of with a theme and pick players that they know. I noticed like yourself in Miami picked a few Warsaw players, which obviously you know a little bit more about them from your history. So I think that that's always a good strategy to take as well.
Well, thank you. And if anything, this is, or at least like in one thing, is it's really revealing like the value of connection to the league, to teams, to players, to your locker room. And like by players investing and building that connection, you know, they can increase their draft value or the value that they have in the league overall. Cause it really feels like, activity and, you know, performance as well, and picking the right progressions and whatnot and having the right build. But it sounds like, paying to have these interpersonal connections really kind of pays off. I guess the second question is like, what teams do you feel should be emulated in the way that they drafted? So like there were the ones that kind of did well, but do you see over time that there are teams that consistently draft well that you feel are like, hey, these are standout teams? Like you mentioned Albuquerque, didn't they get Stig Magnus as the first round pick last year?
I think they had first and second in season 5, and they got Magnus and Alexander maybe, or somebody else at the top there. As far as teams that draft well, I think Copenhagen is up there. They had Kovalchuk and Reeves, I believe, were affiliate picks of theirs a couple seasons ago, and they've developed into great minor league players and now great pro players as well for them. So that's another team I think drafts with a very specific strategy, goes into every draft well prepared, and comes out of it on top because of that. I also think I think Jacksonville picks really well normally as well, even though they're picking a little later and didn't even have a first round pick this time, but they usually get good players. And Alaska always has talented players fall into their lap late as well. So that's, I don't know if that's a strategy to emulate or just you have to get lucky, but they do really well too.
Yeah, certainly, ways to stand out, and certainly some paths you can try to follow, and then other ones that are, you know, just unforeseen and positive for them. Either way, that was sweet. Appreciated you walking through some of the teams. Did you have any like closing thoughts for our viewers today? And really appreciated you hopping on.
Closing thoughts, I think that this community is really good. I've really enjoyed my time working with goals over the seasons. You know, for the most part, people have been pretty positive towards me, and even when I've gone a little while without posting a mock or whatever the case is. So I appreciate that. I appreciate all the extra content that gets done, like you guys on Rinkside doing a great job for sure. And, you know, if anybody in the community has feedback for me or wants to tell me what they want to see more of or less of, you know, my DMs are always open. So, yeah, come by, say hi, and let me know how I'm doing.
Absolutely. Well, we'll share those with our viewers. And, McRoss, thank you so much for hopping on this evening. This was a great ride. I'll see you next time.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Oh, what a fantastic interview / breakdown of the operating rhythm of the draft, and it was like having a celebrity on the show. I'm still a little starstruck. Let me tell you, this was a great ride. Thanks so much for hopping on the Rinkside roller coaster. This is Pawtai signing you out.